when we talk about the 90s web, we hear about GIFs, animated text, or the tables. So many tables. But we don't hear so much about the guestbook, perhaps the most underappreciated progenitor of modern social media. Why is that? Greetings, and welcome to another thrilling episode of Veronica Explains. I'm Veronica, and today I'd like to talk about guestbooks, one of the earliest examples of interactive media on the World Wide Web. As previously defined in my Word of the Week podcast, guestbooks in real life are a type of ledger in which visitors to a particular establishment leave comments for the owners, as well as for future visitors. In the earlier days of the web, web-based guestbooks were simply a cyberspace extension to this concept. You'd leave a message in someone's guestbook, and it acted like a wall of messages, or a feed, if you will. On the early web, guestbooks were used by visitors to a website, ostensibly to share opinions about that website with the website owner, or webmaster for short. Quite often, messages left on these guestbooks were public-facing, meaning anyone visiting the website could see the comments left by other visitors to your website. It was a quaint little internet back then, and it's hard to imagine in today's social media-addled world, where often the comments are a shorthand for terrible experiences we subject ourselves to in exchange for fleeting moments of positive human interaction. But back then, we freely chose to implement these guestbooks, and generally welcomed the comments from random visitors. If you weren't online in the 90s, it's important to remember that this wasn't the era of constant connectivity. At that point, the web just wasn't an ever-present part of our lives, even for those of us who were extremely internet savvy. Going online was still an activity that required sacrifice. Your online time was fleeting. You were tying up the phone line, after all. If you want me to cover more fun from the early web, like web rings, ancient scripting, and the quirks of early HTML, place a comment in the comment bin. Anyway, this wasn't the era of big analytics. We implemented things like hit counters and guestbooks because we wanted to know if folks actually liked our websites. But beyond the intended purpose of general visitor comments, guestbooks gave us a chance to leave messages for each other. Much like the mighty BBS, which rose to prominence in the preceding decade, guestbooks gave us 90s teens a place on the web to chat asynchronously. Unlike chat rooms in which we actively participated in direct discussion with the randos we called internet friends or buddies, the guestbook gave us a way to leave a public message for a friend who wasn't online right now. In message systems that are a bit more private, like email, the message that you leave for a friend isn't exactly designed for everyone to read. And while public message boards like forums, BBSs, and news groups were nothing new by the 1990s, it was still somewhat technically challenging to access them. Guestbooks, on the other hand, were usable by anyone who could work a web browser. This meant that the messages left on them were extremely public. You took time to craft them, and if you owned the website, you spent time curating the messages you'd leave publicly available. In short, the guestbook culture in the 1990s helped lay the path for the social media, which rose to prominence in the following decade. It's an important, yet surprisingly uncelebrated step toward the level of connectedness that we take for granted today. Guestbooks taught a generation of web users about the face work of image crafting, the progenitor of today's influencer culture. Now, of course, it's unfair to paint this as a utopia. You can imagine that with unchecked, public-facing comment sections, there was a lot of cyberbullying happening. And unlike a forum or an email chain or a modern comment section, Guestbooks were mostly linear posts with no simple way to reply to a sender, short of visiting their own guestbook and leaving them a message. You can imagine that this led to some drama. As a teen in the 90s, I absolutely made and lost friends over stupid guestbook wars. And we certainly devised schemes to take down websites by taking advantage of every security loophole we could find in those guestbook scripts. But as a goofy, unathletic, uncoordinated computer nerd in the 90s, all that drama was just the price of admission to a world where I could connect with others of my kind. My guestbook wall was a public testament to my friends, both online and off. I don't know about you, but that affirmation was vital during the cruelest years of teenagedom. Anyway, enough about the nostalgia. How did they work? Guestbooks were mostly implemented in the form of scripts that would run on your web server. Back in the 90s, the nerdiest of web nerds would often set up a free website through providers such as Tripod, AngelFire, or the venerable GeoCities, where every GIF meant every GIF. A lot of ISPs also gave you space to plant an HTML flag, where you could upload files and your ISP would serve them to the web at large. And while home servers weren't out of the question, in my experience, most users with websites during the mid to late 90s were hosting them through one of these providers, or perhaps an educational institution such as a college or a high school. Anyway, the guestbook itself was just another script hosted on the server. And while there were guestbook services that helped you set one up, in my experience, most of us were just stealing scripts from some lousy website and pasting them into our CGI bins with reckless abandon. The programming language for these scripts varied. ASP, PHP, and I've even heard of some JavaScript implementations, but it sounds like the most popular language for these was Perl, the often forgotten language which dominated discourse in the early days of the web. Perl isn't my first language, or my fifth. In fact, I barely ever used it as a kid. Most of the time, I was just copying code from someone else back then. But, to be honest, that's how so many of us got our first taste of programming. And that's not nothing. Anywho, while a few guestbook implementations used a database as a backend, yes, even Microsoft Access, most of the ones I was working with just edited the static HTML file itself. That's right! You type in the form and it modifies the .html file itself. That was always secure. You know, in a very real way, we're coming full circle now with static site generators as the next chic iteration of this classic NoSQL found here design. So now here's the magic question. Can we set one of these up today? Of course, we could just go ahead and set up the same sort of thing using any modern server-side language like PHP, Python, or Ruby. But I wonder, how hard would it be to simply drop a Perl script from the good old days onto a modern website? Now, it should go without saying, but I'm gonna say it anyway, I am not suggesting you do this. It's probably a bad idea for a lot of reasons. But let's have some fun bringing some old code back to life. To start with, I spun up a Debian server and then installed vanilla Apache on it. I'm not going to go into how to install Apache since there's already like 1,000 videos on that topic on YouTube. I started by making a directory in /var/www for my CGI bin. I then changed the owner to www-data, as that's the user Debian uses for Apache. I then set up a virtual host for my fake website and added an exec CGI option, making sure Perl scripts could be handled. I made a little mistake here, which you'll see in a minute. After all of that, I restarted Apache and tested if Perl was working by dumping in a simple test script. It did not. I realized I hadn't yet enabled the CGI modules, and that might have been missing. So I went ahead and enabled them, but things still weren't working. I poked around a bit at my virtual host and realized I didn't alias the CGI bin. Oops. I fixed that up, and then I restarted Apache. Now, when I visited the website, I got an internal server error, which was a different error than I was getting before. So I checked the logs, and I can see that it can't execute the script. So then I made sure that it was executable, but that didn't fix the issue. On a whim, I decided I should make sure that there's a content type header. I don't have to add that to the top of most of my modern web scripts, but I'm no Perl genius, clearly. Anyway, that did it. And so ends the Veronica learns just enough Perl to be dangerous portion of today's video. On a tip from a fellow Mastodon user, I checked out scriptarchive.com. Here, to my astonishment, I found Matt's script archive, which is, in a word, interesting. Definitely worth checking out if you're interested in how we used web technology back in the 1990s. Anyway, on this not-at-all-dangerous website, Matt has a guestbook listed, so I grabbed the files and got to work. There are four primary files we'll use today. Guestbook.pl, which is the Perl script doing the work on the server. AddGuest.html, which is the form visitors will fill out to add to the guestbook. Guestbook.html, which is the guestbook HTML that gets edited here containing the user entries. Oh, that's cute. And hopefully not at all too dangerous for YouTube. And lastly, guestlog.html, a short log of all entries made. As you might be able to imagine, guestbook.pl went into the CGI bin folder, while the HTML files went into the HTML folder. Inside guestbook.pl, there are five variables, and you'll need to set them. Not you. I shouldn't have said you'll need to set. I set them. You don't have to. Anyway, guestbook URL and CGI URL are for modifying your URLs. Guestbook Real and Guestlog tell the Perl script where those files are in your directory. There's also date underscore command, which defines a shell command which returns a date, for use by the script. After making the modifications, I gave it a try and it errored out. Looks like the HTML links aren't dynamically set within the Perl script, because of course they aren't. I fixed that up, but then it errored out. Taking a look at the file permissions in the CGI bin, I can see that I failed to make guestbook.pl executable. Oopsie. Making it executable was the trick. Now I can see my entry and make another one. Of course, and I'm just going to say this again, I can imagine this has a ton of security implications. For starters, the guestbook Perl file is simply editing the HTML file and inserting whatever you type into it. A well-formed, malicious string could probably inject some scary code in here or something. Luckily, it has some strings in here to prevent HTML, and my brief playing with it seems to indicate that it does something to strip out the HTML. I also disabled the logging and the email linking because honestly, I don't need any of you getting spammed just for trying it out. And try it out you should because it seems fun. You can check out my guestbook at gb.don'ttrythis.net. Anyway, I shared this on Mastodon and I got a ton of fun and exciting and nostalgic posts on it. It was incredible. That said, I did have to make one minor modification to the math script archive file. I added a variable for a math quiz to help root out the spammers, because like all things on the modern internet, it only takes a couple of minutes before the spam comments show up. And show up they did. Ugh. I've attempted to solve this the same sort of way we did back in the day. I inserted an if-then into the works that'll pump out an error if you answer the question wrong. Then I defined the answer along with the other variables and explained the problem in the HTML page in a wordy way that only a human would understand. It's kind of like a low-resource, mid-90s version of a CAPTCHA, and we used to do this sort of thing to prevent bots from posting on our pages. It's reasonably effective.
1, 2, 3, 4!
So, do I pine for the intentionality that comes from the early web? Absolutely. I'd be lying if I pretended that I don't. The web wasn't the ever-present dominating force that it is today. The information superhighway wasn't really the road just yet. It was the destination in itself. I don't think it's all bad today. I mean, modern social media has really lowered the barriers to entry, and that's helped keep folks around the world connected together. And I don't think that's a bad thing. That said, I absolutely think it's fair to criticize the juggernauts that rose in the decades that followed the birth of the web. And I think that the guestbook era contains a lot of great examples of a self-hosted, intentionally moderated, deliberate alternative to algorithm-driven gigantic social media platforms. It certainly wasn't utopia, but it was exciting. And for me at least, self-hosted smaller web projects like PeerTube and Mastodon represent a spiritual successor to that excitement. I just think we should give guestbooks more credit for helping lay the groundwork, for better or worse, that led to our modern era.